We are so glad you guys are here. There are connection sheets in the back, and Tracy has mugs at the coffee bar. If you're new, we'd love you to take that gift as a thank you for you joining us this morning. For those of you that are not new, that are been around for a long time, offering is now being collected in the back. There's a box in the back we can give, also online as well. That's for members, people that have made this their church body. If you're new, please don't feel any pressure to give towards that. Something that we have coming up, a really cool opportunity, a lot of times church events are either like church events, very churchy, or like outreach events that are, you know, like just come, eat a burger, welcome your unsaved friends. We have an event coming up that's really geared towards being a middle ground, something that's made for people that are not from the church, that don't have a profession of faith, but to answer a lot of questions. So that is the Alpha course. It's really geared towards people that might have a question of what is this God thing about? Where do I begin? Answer some really basic questions that a lot of people struggle with. And it's geared towards people that really don't have church background, that don't speak the Christianese. So if you have people in your life that you think might be interested in that, a coworker, a friend, a family member, please be praying about inviting that person. It starts June 6th, so a week from this upcoming Monday. Mondays in the evening here at the church, Fellowship Hall. Stephanie is leading it, and I'm excited about that. Stephanie is a wonderful, empathetic person, and also very smart, so she's a very good person to be at the helm there. So if you think about that, praying about that, who can I invite? How can I get some people here for that? I feel like every time I'm announcing guys' night events, but this week I get to announce an event just for the ladies. So thank you, ladies. June 11th in the afternoon is a Saturday. We're doing a ladies' beach day. So I don't know any details about that, but I'm excited. I'll definitely try my best to be there and invite all my ladies to be there as well. The next thing I'm going to announce, I have a partner in crime I'm going to invite to come up with me. Delani, if you want to come up. For those of you who don't know Delani, and have got to walk with her since then, which has been a really cool opportunity just to see her grow from like a middle schooler to now a sophomore in college, technically. So the longest part at Taylor last fall, just finished her freshman year, and we had a really cool opportunity as a church to partner with her. Taylor University does a matching grant, so her local church has an opportunity to get up to $2,000. And that is matched by Taylor every year, which we do the math there over 4 years is $16,000, which is an incredible gift. And if Delani can graduate with $16,000 less in debt, we'd love to see that happen. So Delani's going to share a little bit about this past year to update you guys on what she's learned and how she's grown over the last year. Making a connection with the local local church, because we want them to have a faith community outside of just ICI staff. So bringing Delani to church and allowing her to meet all of you and have a church family that exists in this place, even if she ages out of ICI or things like that happen, that she has believers that she knows that are best in her life. So no pressure, but you guys are a part of making that mission fulfilled. And so seeing her be a part here is really cool for me. And like I said, again, we have an opportunity to continue to partner with her, continue to be a family of faith. We sent her to Taylor last year with that 2,000 plus 2,000 to Taylor, and our goal is to do that again. So from now to the end of June, you can give towards the Benevolence Fund, and I believe give to the general fund, note that it's for the benevolence. Is that correct? Give under benevolence fund instead of general fund. So you can do that online. We want between now and the end of June to come up with that $2,000 again so we can make the most of that money that Taylor's willing to give her. So I would just ask you guys over the next month to consider what some of the Lord's putting on your heart and how to be a part of that. So this is on the list, but I'm just going to pray for Delani. Father God, thank you so much for Delani. God, thank you for what you've done in her life, for the way that you, before she knew you, you knew her, you called her, you equipped her, you sharpened her, you brought forth growth in her life. Thank you that I've seen that up close and personal, and it's an encouragement to my heart of what you're capable of doing, that you love these kids and you want them to come to know you. God, thank you for the encouragement. But that's been to me to see that in Delani's life. God, thank you for this opportunity that you've opened for her to be at Taylor. God, thank you for the way that she's being stretched, that she's coming to know you in a deeper way, being outside of the place where she grew up. She's surrounded by different places, different challenges, and through that is able to see the fullness of your character more richly in a different setting. So God, we thank you for that. We thank you for the way that you're just producing that growth. God, we thank you for this upcoming year, for the new opportunity that she has to be a part of these different organizations and just continue to influence campus to be a place that is equitable and just and loving and honoring to you. So God, thank you for the opportunity that you've given her there. I pray that she just do with us well. God, again, we thank you for knowing her and allowing her to be a part of this church body. We pray this in your name. Amen. There is no kids on today, but we do still have nursery. So the rest of you are released.
Thank you. Eric, you're being so
with us this morning.
talk about some things today. there's a couple people I want to shout out really quickly before we start. This is Jordan Ryan. Jordan Morris. Jeremy Stephanie. Yes, Evelyn, Isaiah. Carl Celso. Yes, oh, there you are. James and Tracy Kearney, all of you have opened your homes, led small group over the last 5 or 6 months, and it has been an incredible blessing for us as a church. Your effort, your time, your care, your planning has helped care for us as a community, and it's felt. Even as someone who, I wasn't in a small group, but my wife was, I like felt it by proxy of her coming home and being encouraged and built up being around the same. So I just want to say thank you, give you guys a huge round of applause again. We are taking a break over the summer, but just know that what we did has made a tremendous impact for us as a church. Would you bow your heads and pray with me this morning? Father, we come this morning, and you know our hearts, you know our thoughts, you know everything going on in our nation, in our community. You know the loss of life, God, in Texas this past week, the pain, the hurt, and the grief of so many. You know what has gone on over this last month in Buffalo, California, thinking about the rainfalls in Brazil, God, causing death and destruction. You know these things, and you know how we are as finite human beings, emotional human beings, so you've created that. So I pray, Father, that as we come in your presence this morning, that you would meet each and every one of us where we are at. Lord, we pray for your comfort, God, for those who are grieving in Texas and all around the nation, around the world this morning. God, we pray, Lord, for you to come and to come soon, God. We long for your return, Jesus. We long for you to make things work. We ask for your wisdom to know our role, God, in doing that in our own spheres. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
This past week, as you know, has been horrific. It's awful. In a month that had already seen a racially motivated mass shooting in Buffalo, a shooting at a Taiwanese church in California, our own city experiencing violence throughout the city, here in Humboldt Park included, and then this week, we were in our office with Diego and Victor and David when Diego said, hey, did you see what happened on the news? And I hadn't. Just awful. You don't even know how to think how to respond. You just want to help God in the moment. And so the rest of the week is just this hit in your stomach. And lesser known, maybe you've heard, there's a report that came out about the Southern Baptist Convention cover up, 2-decade cover up of abuse in the church. And another one, God, what is wrong in the church? And God has made us as emotional human beings. We've been talking about this over the last month. Not just to experience joy on good days, but to grieve and to mourn as well. And he's also given us an emotion that recognizes threats, recognizes dangers to us, to our community, and rather than shirking back and hiding, hones in and fights. God has given us the emotion of anger. He's given that to us. Some of you this morning might be thinking like, whoa, I've never actually thought that anger could be a good thing given to us. God has given us this emotion. Sometimes we call it by other things. We might call it being perturbed or annoyed or irritated or resentful. One person said that frustration is just anger in a tuxedo. And right now we're experiencing a corporate, national anger, collectively acknowledging a threat and feeling about how to mitigate it. We've got to do something. But this morning I'm going to bring it a little bit more personal, because I know what it's like to get angry about large social things and feel very righteous in so doing, and at the same time that anger is growing in my life and in my heart and causing damage to people close to me, to friends, to family members. And while I think I'm being very righteously angry, and probably am in some ways, that anger is taking advantage of that and wreaking havoc to those close to home. So that's where we're going to sort of hone in today. I'm going to personify anger as either a friend or a foe in our lives. And I want us to think about how we can ensure it's a friend. And I'm intentionally wording it this way because most of us would immediately say that we shouldn't be friends with anger, that it's not a good thing to have as an intimate companion. Rather than taking the time to explore what anger is, why we've been given this emotion, the fact that God has this emotion, instead we try to ignore it, and in ignoring it, it actually creates so much more harm to us and those around us. So how can anger be a friend this morning? How can it help us grow in our identity as a follower of Jesus, recognizing threats and giving us the energy to address them? How can anger be a friend that helps you to fight for life and life abundantly instead of a foe, or one who misleads you about what is wrong and how to address it? One who seeks to have you serve the enemy in helping to steal, kill, and destroy. So this morning, here's where we're going to go. We're going to define anger. We're going to talk about God's relationship with anger. And then we're going to look at Ephesians 4 and talk about, hey, how can anger be our friend instead of our foe? As we begin, I want us to think about what is anger. And I have this definition for us. It's the emotional response that we have to an external or internal event perceived as a threat, a violation, or an injustice. It's the emotional response that we have to an external, something outside of us, or internal. We feel it. We feel that there's this threat perceived as a threat, a violation, or an injustice. And it's a protective emotion to ensure safety. Right? If you've ever stubbed your toe, I trust that all of you have stubbed your toe. And you respond, right? You respond with an emotion. What is that emotion?
Anger.
Great job. And you probably respond either saying something out loud, maybe it's not the best thing, but if it's something that you can alleviate, if you can remove that, right? If it's like, why is this in the middle of the room? Who put this here? And you move it. You get rid of that threat so that it doesn't happen again. It's a sort of a silly example, but it illustrates a lot of threats that we experience in our lives. Anger has great power to protect or to harm. There might be people who have harmed you, and you're like, I gotta get them out of my life. And you can do that in unhealthy ways. And it happens physically in our amygdala. It's the fight or flight operation inside of you that's saying, hey, either I'm gonna shirk back or I'm gonna hold in and destroy this threat. And your heart rate rises, your breathing increases, you get more oxygen, you're like, let's go. This is given by God to address threats in our lives. But if we don't know how to handle it, that will cause a lot of harm. One person described it as like a tree shooting out from roots by a person, I'm just going to shout out Tracy Kearney. She's really smart, and I had the privilege of asking her, hey, talk to me about anger. So I definitely recommend, if you want helpful wisdom and skill, talk with Tracy. She was referring to anger as shoots that come out of the roots of fear and grief. Fear and pain. That you've experienced something that has hurt you in the past, and out of that
experience of the past in anticipation of fear of the future that happens again, anger grows, whether physical, emotional, or otherwise. And as we've been talking about our stories, right, who we are as people who are born in families that are sinful, because we're sinful people, that we've been sinned against, and the different things that this has caused, whether it's shame or pain in other ways, and fear is part of that. These are not all disconnected, but they're intimately attached. Real quickly, I just want to mention four styles of anger, and as I mentioned these, I want you to think about your family, and I want you to think about maybe their most common style, because chances are you probably have this style as well. We have aggressive. This is just as you would expect. You have anger and you just let it out, right? Like, you disagree and you let everyone know that you are disagreeing and you're very angry about it. Passive aggressive. Outwardly agreeable, but showing that in anger through indirect actions. Through sarcastic comments. And if someone tries to, like, oh, I'm like, okay, great, like, no, I'm not. Like, I'm totally fine. Full transparency, someone who already knows this is probably where I would land. Passive aggressive. Or you got passive. You don't let yourself feel that. It comes up and pops up in other ways, but you anger, you just lock it up. Maybe growing up you never saw anger expressed in a healthy way, and you're like, oh, I'm never gonna let that come out. Or lastly, assertive, where anger is appropriately managed and communicated if necessary. Hone in, hey, this is a threat to my family, to my this relationship, to myself, and I need to address it in a healthy way. Anger is pointed towards something. Anger notices something, is something wrong, and gives you the energy to respond. Anger notices something that's contrary to what you want, contrary to your will, contrary to your desire, whether it's waiting in line at a grocery store, and all of a sudden you're like, I just want to get home and relax, it's like 5:15, I'm ready for dinner, and that person pulls out coupons. You're like, we still have these? And it's always like, the person who has one has 12 of them, right? Like, you're like, you try not to, like, get angry at the people around you, or then you start driving. Try not to get angry. Or weeks like this, where extreme injustice happens. If something is wrong, there is a threat that needs to be addressed. Or maybe you're in a conversation, and somebody doesn't agree with you. And it's so obvious that they should agree with you because you're right all the time. And you're like, I just can't let this go. So you know what? I'm going to keep having the last word and they throw in the last word. You're like, no, that's not how this is going to go. And you respond and it escalates in anger. Whether it's always having to have the final word or cutting down those around you, anger causes us often to suppress others' choices, to consume and condemn others, using them to achieve our desired ends. But it can also serve as our friend. It can serve as one who alerts you to threats that need to be addressed. And what's interesting is that God is described in Scripture as having anger. I want to talk for a moment about God's relationship with anger and have a couple false ideas and true ideas stated. The first false one is that God is a God of anger. The truth is that God is a God of love. Say, hold up, you just said that God is a God of anger. Here's what I mean by that. God, in and of himself, before creation, before we were on the scene, was not God a God of anger. They describe these as his attributes, who he is in and of himself, not in relationship to us. It's hard to think about, right? He didn't have any cause to be angry because sin wasn't running rampant. He's a God of love. The next one is this, that because he, something false, is that because he's a God of love, then he doesn't have anger or wrath. The truth is that the Bible tells us that God is angry. And we'll look at this more closely in a moment. The last falsehood that I want us to notice is that, you know, God in the Old Testament, he was angry, but now in the New Testament, God is just love. Scripture teaches us that God never changes. What I mean by that is not that God is somehow numb, silent, just blank face all the time, doesn't care, but that God is always and forever consistent with his character. Always. Here are a couple of quotes that I found really helpful to think about God's anger, God's wrath. James Bryan Smith says that God's wrath is a mindful, objective, rational response. It is actually an act of love. And God is not indecisive when it comes to evil. God is fiercely and forcefully opposed to the things that destroy his precious people. That it is a sign of God's love. That God's wrath must be understood in relation to his love. Wrath is not a permanent attribute of God. Whereas love and holiness are part of his essential nature, wrath is contingent upon human sin. If there were no sin, there would be no wrath. And J.I. Packer notes that one of the things we humans cannot escape, and I would add should not escape, is our longing for fairness and justice. He says, I do not want a universe in which there is no justice, no right and wrong, and I do not want a God who is indifferent to moral evil. Praise God that he's not. Praise God that this week he's not just passively looking back and be like, this is your mess. That he's feeling grief with us, and he's saying, no, this is something that needs to be addressed. But God is not angry because he feels threatened, attacked, or worried that he might be overcome. His anger is set against injustice. Injustice, which is any violation of God's design for life. Anything that breaks shalom, peace, life is as it should be. That anything that breaks it, God said, no, I'm opposed to that. And God has designed and blessed anger in order to energize our passion to destroy sin. God has designed and blessed anger in order to energize our passion to destroy sin. Anger can be lovely and redemptive, but it can also be ugly and vindictive. But the absence of anger, saying, you know what, I'm not going to get angry, is the choice to remain unaffected by sin. It's saying, you know what, God, there's part of how you created me and part of who you are that I don't want. I want to be unaffected by sin. Anger can be our friend or our foe. I want to turn to Ephesians 4, 25 through 32. And I'm going to read the passage, and then as I make the points, I actually don't have the passage listed up there, so I encourage you to pull it up on your phones, or if you need a Bible, let me know. We've got a lot of Bibles in the back, but to follow along with me. And Paul is writing this beautiful book to the church of Ephesus, speaking about what Christ has done for us, and saving us and creating a new community centered upon him. In the first, or in the final three chapters, he lays out what this practically looks like. He's just kind of done explaining how we are to put off our old self and to put on the new self, created to be like God, created to honor him, created to image the glory of God, as we talked about last week. And then Paul begins to get really practical. He says this, therefore, putting away lying, speak the truth, each one to his neighbor. Because we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. And don't give the devil an opportunity. Let the thief no longer steal. Instead, he is to do honest work with his own hands, so that he has something to share with anyone who needs. No foul language should come from your mouth, but only what is good for building up someone in need, so that it gives grace to those who hear. And don't grieve God's Holy Spirit. You were sealed by him for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, anger, and wrath, shouting, and slander be removed from you, along with all malice, and be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another, just as God also forgave you. In order for anger to be a friend, you've got to have boundaries. You've got to have some strong boundaries in this friendship. And I'm going to describe them as sort of like a block club sign. I don't know how many of you in driving around have noticed blocks when you have it on doors that has a sign with a list of the rules on that block. Yeah, here are some examples. And I'm curious, some of you have some crazy signs that have like some real interesting things. What's your favorite on your sign?
no mechanic work can be done on the street.
No mechanic work. Anyone else have favorite prohibitions on your block club sign or one that you've seen? Sign. Don't leave packages outside. Amazon's driving around like, what are you supposed to do? Don't order anything. It's interesting because somebody put that there for a reason, right? Somebody acknowledged that this leads to something. And we're just going like, I don't get it. I don't get why we can't do mechanical work. But somebody was like, hey, when this happened, bad things start to happen at some point in some place. But Paul, in this passage, gives a lot of helpful boundaries for how we should corral anger and allow it to serve God's purposes and not our own. So the first thing that we notice is no lying. No lying in the kingdom love. He says, therefore, putting away lying, speak the truth, each one to his neighbor, because we are members of one another. In order for anger to be afraid, commit to truth. Commit to truth. Any other form of communication is a lie in acting based on non-reality. And how many of you know that it's really easy when you get angry to sort of forget the truth part? And we know full well that politicians and the media play into this to a huge degree. Like, we'll just sort of share a small amount of the truth, not the whole truth, and like give a soundbite, and people will think like, oh, I heard the soundbite, and I don't actually have to like do the work to find all the facts, I'm just angry. And now because I'm angry, I'm going to respond a certain way. Or maybe you're just like, I haven't gotten, you know, that text from somebody who said they would text me, and rather than just assume, or rather than just like calling or saying like, hey, like, they're probably busy, like all of us forget to text. I was bored last night for a moment this morning too. I was like, yeah, I texted this person on Tuesday or Wednesday, oh my goodness. Well, right, when you start getting angry, you start making assumptions. You start saying, you know what, why didn't they text me? Well, hey, because they never text me back. And you like go down the list and you make assumptions. And Peace Zero says this: every time I make an assumption about someone who is hurt or disappointing me, without confirming it, I actually believe a lie about this person in my own head. This is not about you not texting back, by the way, all right? Like, one of the beauties of pastoring is that if you learn how people communicate, and there are people I know, like, they're not going to text you back. If you need them, call them, right? FaceTime them. Something. Make sure you know the facts. Because people want you to be angry to serve their purposes. Because if they can get you angry, your God-given emotion that recognizes the threat and gives them energy to respond, then you have energy to respond to what they want, which is not actually possibly true, nor is it necessarily what God wants. Take time to know the facts. The facts. Put away lying. No lying. Secondly, no sinning. It says, be angry and do not sin. Quoting Psalm 4. And I interpret this as a little bit more of a permissive than like a strict command. I don't think it's like, you know what, today, be angry. I think it's an acknowledgement that God has given us anger and that there's a permission there. And you can give this emotion. And there are times where you should be angry. And when you're angry, do not sin. And I'm going to sum it up this way. Don't allow anger to cause you to seek your own benefit. Get your own way at the expense of dishonoring others and their decisions. What that doesn't mean is that you should never recognize a threat to you. Recognize a threat to yourself that needs to be addressed. That doesn't mean like, oh, if I act on this, it's actually to my benefit, so I shouldn't do that. That's not what that means. But it does mean that oftentimes anger leads us to suppress others' choices, insisting on, no, I need to get my way. And if you don't get in line, then you're not allowing God to give what he wants. Because oftentimes we think that our way is God's way. And it could be a good result. You could come before your company, you could come before your class and say, I have this great idea. It could be a great idea. And then if people don't get on board, you often can get angry, right? And rather than saying, hold up, I should not sin, I don't go around people's back and say, like, did you feel that they were on board? And then you start, like, cutting down other people condemning, you say, all right, how can I actually respond in a way that convinces them that this is where you are? You know what? I actually need to do a better job of responding. Be angry and do not
sin. Do not sin, because God doesn't simply care about the results. He cares about the manner in which they come about as well. And he's given us anger not just to achieve results, but to pursue righteousness and fight sin, even in the process of getting results. Which is important as we think about this moment nationally that we're in. We say, we want to see certain results. We want to see things happen, and we might think that no matter what it takes to get there, no matter if it requires demonizing whatever the other side is, that this is where we want to go. Be angry and do not sin. No sinning, no loitering. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. Don't let anger loiter in your life. Don't let it take longer than it needs to accomplish its purposes, because how many of you know that when anger begins to come, it likes to just settle. It likes to call all its friends and be like, hey, we found a great place to live. And next thing you know, you've got a whole block of anger just living there, not paying rent, just wanting to stay forever. Don't let anger loiter in your life. Allow it to energize you for the purpose that God has for it. And you guys, you gotta move along. I don't want you to stay here forever. I want to be careful, because we can often oversimplify this verse and be like, what it means is that every night you need to make sure you don't go back in. Which, if you live in like way up north in the northern hemisphere and it's winter time, like you've got like an hour of sunlight and you've got to wrap up all your anger real quick because it's dark out. What's helpful is to interpret this as, don't let anger simmer into an overflowing boil over time. Don't let it just linger and keep growing and keep growing and keep growing when you should be addressing this. But what's harmful is to say, I'm going to force this conversation with this person even though they're not ready for it. You need to know who you're angry with. And the loving way of responding to anger is saying, what is the best way to address this with this person? Like, if your spouse, your friend, is not a night person, and you are, and you're like, I gotta get this off my chest before we're done with the day, and they're like, I'm wiped out. Don't come quoting scripture and say, you know what? Scripture says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. So right now, we're gonna talk. Now, for me and my wife, it pushes us a little to the other edge, where it says, hey, like, we both are more like passive, we're not verbal processors. We can let things linger until it's like I have the exact way of wording it. And we need to learn, like, no, you gotta not let things go a week. Like maybe 36 hours. Or maybe saying at the end of the night, you know what, I'm angry, but we're really tired. So I think maybe actually like sleeping on it and spending some time with the Lord in the morning might be better, but I am angry. That's okay. No loitering. Next, no soliciting. Don't give the devil an opportunity. This word for opportunity is like the word for foothold, right? And when your friend angers at the door, he's going to let in everybody, right? If you're not watching him, if you're not careful, he's going to let the devil come in with all sorts of things that the devil's trying to sell while you're angry. You know what? You're angry at this person? Let me just sort of sneak this in, too. Rather than you actually addressing a very real and important threat, now all of a sudden you're like, and all of this, too, I need to address. Why don't I matter? Maybe some of you have felt this week. I know I have. Where you go, you know what? I am frustrated and I'm angry about what's going on nationally, as I should be. And then you start thinking of people. And you go, you know what? I'm angry at them, too. And I'm angry at... Because you let the devil come and solicit and say, you know what, I've got some other things to sell. No, don't let anger let the devil in. You got to be aware. You got to be aware of why God is giving you this emotion and the dangers if you just don't let it run rampant. No soliciting, no stealing. Let the thief no longer steal. Instead, he is to do honest work with his own hands, so that he has something to share with anyone in need. But I don't really see how this connects with anger. But how many of you know that when you are angry and you demonize your foe, then it's really easy to say, I can take what's yours and make it mine because I'm angry at you and I can justify it. Yeah, nah, I don't do that. I'm angry at the government, the city,
this person who is actually having a really rough day and actually needs some of my emotional energy, but I'm so angry, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to rob them of what I should give them. As a spouse, as a friend, I say, you know what, maybe I should be listening in this moment and just slowing down for a moment. I say, no, I'm going to take that. It's mine. You say, that might be a stretch, but I don't know about you, but that's my life sometimes, where I go, no, I just want to take mine, because I'm angry. No stealing, no foul language. It says, no foul language should come from your mouth. Your version might say, no corrupting language. No foul language. So this means basically like, you have rotten food, like you throw milk out in the garbage, and you hopefully know when your garbage man comes, and you know like, no, don't throw dairy out a week ahead of time, because you're going to be out in the backyard smelling it all week long. You wait, you keep it in the fridge, you throw it out like that morning or day of. Why? Because it doesn't smell good. You're all trying to enjoy life, and you're smelling something future. You know what I'm talking about. You know. And anger, foul language is that putrid stuff that comes out of your mouth. And people are having a good time, and you've got this underlying anger, and you're just spewing out things. You got a question? Keep that hand raised. Let me know if you think of it. No foul language should come from your mouth. But it says this, but only what is good for building up someone in need so that it gives grace to those who hear. You guys remember the game of Angry Birds? You just like destroy things with these little birds? Like that's our anger if we just let it go mouth off all the time. Just cutting down this person and consuming that person. Did you hear about what they did? And you're just cutting people down all the time instead of letting your words serve as a scaffolding, holding people up, or serving like mortar, helping people stay together, or like bricks, depending on the occasion, giving truth, love, care, concern, building up those. What does this look like when somebody comes to you like, did you hear about what they said? Maybe you're the agent in someone's life that just says, hey, let's just slow down. Let's try to think of your perspective. James, you do a great job of this, and it bothers me, because you're such a devil's advocate, and I oftentimes really, really dislike that. But it's really helpful, because you just don't allow me to get away with whatever I want. You're like, oh, you know, but I can see what they're saying. No, I can't see what they're saying, James.
But I don't text you back.
But you don't text me back, right? All of you who don't text me back, it's right here, man. Just did. You don't send us such a call. Putrid talk weakens the Christian community, and it diminishes, and what diminishes God's temple breeds God's spirit. It's what Lynn Cohen says. Putrid talk weakens the Christian community, and what diminishes God's temple, that's gospel church, breeds God's spirit. You see this in the next verse. And don't grieve God's Holy Spirit. You were saved by him for the day of redemption. I'm going to sum this up. There's no offending the Holy Spirit. This is a sobering verse. Think about the Spirit of God given to us that dwells within us individually and us corporately. And think about the Holy Spirit who innocently grieved. How do you want to grieve that? That's not what it means to be a Christian. No. You're saying that about someone that I love and I live in as well as the Holy Spirit. And we need the Spirit of God. We need the Spirit of God to grow in our lives. The last thing I want to do is to grieve the Spirit of God and say, nah, I don't actually want you to move in this way, or I don't actually want you here, I just want you to achieve the purposes I want. No, that's called manipulating and using the Spirit of God for our purposes. We need to submit to the Spirit and say, nah, I want to know when you're grieved. I want to know what breaks your heart. I want to know when you're quickly, I pause and I stop that. Just what the next verse says, and he summed it up this way. See trash, throw it out. Let all bitterness, anger, and wrath, shouting, and slander be removed from you, along with all malice. And I hope you're paying enough attention this morning that you go, hold up a second. It says, all anger needs to be removed. And all I'm going to say is that don't take one Bible verse and build your whole thought of a topic off one Bible verse. Right? It's really easy just to like hear one, clean it out. You hear, be angry, I should be angry. Someone else says, nope, you gotta get rid of all anger. Bible-believing believers battling it out because it's a huge topic. It's a huge topic, and it takes this beautiful book of scripture to let us know God's thoughts about it and how it should serve us as a community and be pleasing to Him. So there's this interesting progression in this passage. Little bitterness, that which is inside of us when we feel like, man, someone else is treating us unfavorably. We compare our situation to someone, why do they have that and I don't? Why did they get promoted? I don't. And it begins to stir inside of us. And it begins to lead to some anger. You set your sights on this threat. Now, they're a problem with me achieving what I want. No. They're a threat. And you begin to hatch some plans. It leads to wrath, this more outward expression. And then it even says it, shouting. Your version might say clamor, however you say it, shouting. And how many of us know that anger often leads to shouting? So the more aggressive anger types. Next thing you know, you're at a party and somebody's raising their voice and someone's matching them and the shouting is happening and the slandering. You are cutting down other people. You're speaking evil of one another. All of this can be summed up with the term malice. This planning, this plotting of how to harm other people. Paul says, get rid of all of it. Like, you walk down the street and you see trash all over. You see someone drive by and they throw up their trash, and I don't know about you, but it makes me angry. As it should, because that's a threat to our community. You're like, go get that out of here. We need to have that same sort of vigilance and mindset with bitterness in our hearts. Like, cut it early. It's hard when it's at a shouting level. It's really hard to cut it out then. Cut it out early. Why? Because we are neighbors working together for our community. The text says, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another, just as God also forgave you in Christ. When anger is your friend, it leads to greater intimacy with God and care for your community. It helps you grow as an identity in your identity as a follower of Jesus. It helps you to remember that, man, I'm invited on the kingdom, but I'm living here only because of the forgiveness of God. I've been given the Spirit of God only because God loves me so much and wants to dwell with me. I'm not here because I like bought my way in. I'm not here because I deserve it. I'm here because God loves me, was kind and compassionate and forgiving to me. I am here because of grace. I'm here because the anger of God, the wrath of God, landed on His Son because they love us so much. I want to close this morning. We're not real close to being done, so don't get your hopes up. But I want to close this morning just talking real practically. We're going to call it the anger management toolbox. Because I wanted to take some time, because we don't talk about anger very often or conflict very often, to like talk really practically what this could look like in our life. And I'm going to use the illustration of a balloon to illustrate getting angry. We have all sorts of reasons to be angry. Maybe you don't have AC and you were not have a good night of sleep, you're getting frustrated because you're hearing your neighbors like play a lot of music. You wake up and you're already a little angry. And then you go down and you run out of coffee because the last person who used it didn't go get coffee. By the way, this honestly never happens. This coffee is like super top priority in my house, so I hope it is a new. And then by the time you're like interacting with other people, you already have an edge. You're already just looking. And someone like says something, is annoying. You know the people who just like their existence sort of makes you angry because they just feel like a threat and maybe they are. So now you're at like 9:30 in the morning, you're already at this level of anger. And you get done with work and you're about to drive home and traffic is traffic. And now you're walking back into the door. There's still no coffee bought for tomorrow. There's toys everywhere. And you're like this. And if you don't know how to healthfully decrease some of this pressure, what's going to happen? what's going to happen? It's going to pop. And it's probably going to pop on people close to you. You're all ready for me to pop it. I don't really have a pin or anything, but Has anyone ever been angry at you, Jesus? Have you ever felt anger?
Yes.
Do you know what to do with it? Do you know what to do with it? You wrestle people. That's a good soap. Look, we have a goal in that room. Why did you get angry when you were wrestling? Couldn't find something. It's understandable. I get angry when I can't find something. You know why? Because it's a threat to me, like experiencing life as I want to. Like, who put this somewhere? Can you get a balloon? Afterwards. Maybe it's not worth your energy, right? You see that person once a year, it's not worth your energy, most likely. Humor, learning how to have moments of humor, how to cultivate humor, how to have moments of being able to relax and laugh with friends, not at the expense of others. Physical exercise, I mean, you said it, wrestling. That's great. Wrestling, physical exercise, and getting out and going for a walk or a run, like that is extremely helpful. You're beginning to let out some anger. Increasing life mastery. I think this is really interesting and helpful because there are things that make me upset that I wish I were better at. Mm-hmm. And maybe that anger is saying, you know what, you should learn how to be better at that. Like, you should be really good at that. And let that anger say, I want to learn. I want to be good at this for the glory of God and the blessing of the community. And so then you feel skilled and you've got a God-given skill and you've learned hearts and you don't have anger. You're like, I'm not as competent. Someone said realistic expectations. I think you said that, Carla. Having realistic expectations. And I hope that as we've been going through this series and learning stories, that that means saying, you know what, that person said that in such a way. But the more I get to know that person, I know that their childhood, their background, their experience, it makes a lot of sense. Or my experience, why I responded. And you begin to give each other and yourself grace because you're saying, man, would it make sense? Do I want to be going? Yes, to be setting realistic expectations. So now we're down to here. And now you're ready to say, how am I going to address this threat? And I'm going to talk for just a moment about actually like confronting someone. I realize we're almost like over that 12 o'clock. Like when you're like, you know what, I need to talk with this person. Scripture gives a lot of wisdom about slowing down and waiting. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. And talking with Tracy, it just works as you slow down, literally counting and breathing. Breathing in, something like 4 seconds, and counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, holding it, 1, 2, 3, breathing out, 6 seconds, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That in your brain, what's happening is the anger that's taken over the right side of your brain, and it's just like, you need to respond like the Hulk. All of a sudden, in counting, you're rebooting your brain, the left and the front side. You're rebooting it to say, no, let's think for a moment rationally about how to respond. Not that the left brain is the only thing that matters. You're bringing them into integrate, which is super helpful. So you've thought about it. What is the threat? What desire is being injured? Good desire, my own or God's? You thought about it, you prayed through it, you're going to talk with the person. Use soft tones. It's not helpful coming in with that tone, right? And the more you know the person, you know the tone that could really be used in a harmful manner. Use soft tones. Use the Oreo method, right? Affirm on both ends of it. Hey, I really appreciate your role in my life. I need you in my life. And then you say what it is that you need to address. And say it in using I statements. Don't say like a lot of us have noticed. That's not helpful. And say like, when you do A, I feel B. Say it after me. When you do A,
when I do A,
I feel B.
I feel B.
When you don't invite me, I feel excluded. And what you're doing is you're allowing the person to be vulnerable. You're allowing them to know how it feels. It's not hard to attack someone who's letting you know how they feel. And avoid using shoulds. Like, here's what's bothering me. You should do this, this, this. You should stop watching TV because it's really unhealthy. You're suppressing their choice and you're making them feel like you just determined what they should do. Instead, say, like, I've noticed you've been down a lot, and I think some physical exercise might be really helpful, and I would love to go for a walk with you. Wow, you just noticed them. You've noticed that they're down, and you've offered to come alongside and care for them, like, all in one fell swoop. And then ending with affirmation. Thank you so much for listening. Like, I know that was hard, and I just want you to know I value you so much. Lastly, when someone confronts you, how many of you like being confronted? Someone saying something that bothers them about you. Slow down. Listen. Thank them. Thank you so much for bringing that to my attention. Again, soft tones. Validate their emotion. This is hard. I'm so sorry, I made you feel that way. It makes total sense how you felt that way. Restate, am I hearing you correctly? This is like getting to the facts. Like, am I actually hearing you correctly? And in doing these steps, you've already bought yourself time. So you're not just reacting emotionally, like, but you're already beginning to thoughtfully respond. And it might be that you don't say more than that. So you know what? I actually need to take some time to think about this. You don't have to respond right away. Take some time. Maybe you need to apologize. Maybe you need to sit back down and say, hey, I think we should talk about some of the facts that led to this. It would be helpful to be on the same page. But think of anger, as this person described it, as a surgical weapon designed to destroy ugliness and restore beauty in the hands of one. one who is framed in love and who can envision beauty. The knife of righteous anger is a weapon for restoration. Realize to stop letting air out. All of those things allow anger to dissipate in a healthy manner. Would you stand with me? And as we close this morning, I just want to acknowledge that some friendships are only for a season, right? You know those people? We had seasons. They moved on. That was great for the season. Anger is one of those friendships that won't be with us forever. There will be a time where we are in new heavens and new earth. There's no more sin. There's no more pain. There's no more grieving. There's no more fear. And we won't need anger. But for now, it is with us, and it's a God-given gift for us to live here and now. There's been saints for centuries, millennia, who have allowed anger to bring about justice. And it could be that this morning and this week, as God has been stirring things in your heart, that He have you address situations in your life, in your community, in your life, in a just and righteous manner. So, Lord, we ask God that you would help us to have anger be our friend, to be used by you, God, to address threats, God, in a healthy way. God, that when we feel a certain way, we would be able to slow down and say, God, what are you trying to speak to? God, I don't want to grieve you. I don't want to cut down my community. God, that we would be a people who use anger like a surgical instrument, God, for righteousness. God, help us to be those people, Lord, and help us, God, to be gracious when others are. God, help us to be a kingdom buffer, Lord, when others are angry, God, that even our response would be a spirit-led moment of saying, kingdom life is living. Now, I don't need to shout in response to you. Lord, help us. We need your help as we move forth and do that. Empower us by your Holy Spirit, let our lives be pleasing to you, Father, glorifying to you, Son. Jesus, we pray all these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Be blessed, church. Have a great Sunday.
Charlene's birthday today.